It's funny, actually, because I've get caught an awful lot of controversy when I start talking with the lads in the pub about favourite Clash albums, because most people instantly will cite the first one or London's Calling. I love Give 'Em Enough Rope.
It was blasted at the time for being AOR, but that's purely because Sandy Pearlman's involved. But I just thought a great song's a great song, and there's some brilliant, you know, Drug Stabbing Time and Safe European Homes and Stay Free, you know, one of the greatest Mick Jones songs of all time. You know, how can you fault that album? Apart from they'd gone in a decent studio.
Well, it was basically Bernie's idea, you know, to bring in Sandy Pearlman. And it did split the Clash camp in half, really, because, I mean, either he went with that idea, he wanted, you know, or he didn't, and the end product speaks for itself. I mean, there's some good songs on there, but the production is not really, it's not my idea of how the Clash should sound.
Well, I was waiting for Give 'Em Enough Rope. I mean, you know, I probably had a calendar or something ticking off the days. And, you know, that album has been sort of much maligned over the years. And I'm not sure if it's an album that they're really proud of. But I loved it. I mean, I loved it in 20-foot high capital letters.
We had a bit of a second album crisis, just as much as any group does, because when you do your first album, you're playing the stuff that you'd be playing anyway before you do your record. So you do all your best stuff, and then they go like, "Where's the next record's due?" You know what I mean? And then you ain't got nothing, so you've got to go and write something and come up with something. But not really. People do look at it as far as we're concerned as a transitional record to our next one. But I really think that they're all okay, and they're really like representative and documents of where we were at that time, and each one is different, you know what I mean? They've all got their own good things about them.
We met when we were at school. Never took no shit from no one. We weren't fools. A teacher says we're done.
Stay Free is an anthem that, you know, I won't sing it for you, but, you know, I mean, I know that song, you know, almost kind of sort of, you know, kind of sort of word perfect. You know, it was, I mean, that could have been about me and some of my friends at school, you know.
I think he was in prison at the time, so it was just kind of like, it was like writing a letter to him, as far as I remember. I was writing a few letters, so I kind of did it musically.
Mick turned up and he said, "Look, I've written this song about you." And he sat down and played it to me on an acoustic guitar. And I was just knocked out. I thought, wow, that's very nice.
I always remember when he kind of turned up from prison at like Dunstable, Queen's Hall or something. And he'd come straight from prison. He had his bag over his shoulder. He was outside the stage door and writing it. So he came straight out of prison and went on tour with us.
One, I can't remember where the gig was, but it was somewhere in the Midlands, I think, and the band were just about to go on stage, and suddenly there's this knock on the door, and there's this American accent going, it's me, let me in, you know, and persisted and knocked on the door, and suddenly he burst open through the door. And of course, it was Sandy Pearlman, so I just fucking hit him. And Bernie rushed over and with his handkerchief to mop up all the blood all over the place. And it was a big palaver, and Mick was laughing his head off. We just thought it was hilarious. That was his introduction to the Clash, really. And I wish I'd hit him a lot harder, having heard the album. But there you are.
Well, that picture of me on the cover of Black Market Clash is quite funny, because if you look at the picture, it's like Don Letts is fronting all these cops. Truth is, behind me there's all these brothers with bricks and bottles that are ready, about to kick off, and in front of me there's a row of cops. And I'm sort of about to cross the road, and I look over my shoulder and I look ahead of me, and I'm like, you know what, I better get out of the way. Unbeknownst to me, somebody snaps a picture, and so the legend unfolds, you know. But the truth is, I was getting out of the way.
We'll be right back. London Calling has that reputation as being one of the greatest records ever, you know, top 10 or 20 of all the hundreds of thousands of albums that have ever been released.
You know, if you took their first two albums, they were very much, you know, okay, we are the punk rock band. They've established their trademark, they established their sound. London Calling threw that all out the window.
By the time of London Calling, the perspective was more global, was more universal.
The kind of the first and second wave of punk rock bands were, you know, probably they'd either already petered out or were at their peak.
Punk was really sort of a naughty word, a nasty bygone thing, even though it was only 2 years down the line. So by the time they did release London Calling, they'd sort of just crossed to every genre, and the people that were buying it were no longer punk fans or even verified Clash fans. It was just people who liked music.
On that album, they became a kind of a soul band. They became a kind of a disco band. You know, there's a jazz on it. There's sort of barroom piano ballads.
You know, the image was beginning to sort of change a bit then as well. You know, the kind of sort of 50s rock and roll look was, you know, coming in. You know, the quiffs and the, you know, the sort of Homburg hats and the kind of Crombie, the long Crombie overcoats as well.
London Calling was created in an atmosphere of magic. I was present at most of the sessions for that one, and Guy Stevens was producing it. His technique was throwing a chair against the wall. You know, this is all famous stuff, you know, pouring a bottle of red wine into the grand piano, which didn't go down a storm.
Maybe because it was like showing that what we were called punk, but yeah, that meant that punk can be anything. Almost, and maybe that's what it was, I don't know, I can't tell, but I never can tell, but I think it was probably something like that, rather than this had a future for everybody. You could do what you want, really, truly.
It rightfully gets the respect that it was given. I mean, I think Rolling Stone voted it the album of the decade for the 80s, even though it was actually released in 1979.
I went to the playback, and it was stunning hearing it from beginning to end, London Calling for the first time. Strummer bound me up in gaffer tape with an eight ball taped somewhere very personal with a crash helmet on my head and threw me on a pool table. That's how I heard it. At 6 in the morning, but it still sounded amazing.